You have an idea for this game. You watched some tutorials, added some enemies, created a player character, you have the latest graphics card, 4090 Ti, but for some reason your game runs slowly at only 20 FPS. Then you start having these self-doubting thoughts because you just realize that a full-fledged game like Red Dead Redemption 2 runs at steady 60 FPS. On a microwave, while your empty project that contains only placeholder white cubes burns more electricity than a Bitcoin farm. If you can relate to this, then watch this video till the end and I will tell you exactly what you are doing wrong. It's the same reason why all those early access games on Steam are always laggy. It's because their developers didn't subscribe to my channel. And if you also didn't subscribe, please do it. Now let's begin our video. You are already probably familiar with an update loop. It's one of those first things that you will ever learn in Unity. An update loop is only executed once per frame. But what does that mean? If your game is running at 60 FPS, that means that an update loop will execute exactly 60 times. If you tell Unity to print Hello World in an update loop, it will print it 60 times every second. So this is only a simplified way of how it works. I assume that many of you have used an update loop before, but what if you are unaware that you are doing something wrong? In that case, I'm going to guide you through some points of what you could be doing wrong and provide you with some alternatives. Recently, a friend of mine reached out to me to help him with his code. He showed me this class of enemy where he checks whether enemy is dead or not. If it's true, then it proceeds to destroy the enemy game object. If it's not true, then it returns out of the method. The only problem with his approach is that he is doing all of this in an update loop. So that means that his CPU will keep checking the enemy state forever. Is this really necessary? In a real case scenario, you would want to know the enemy state only when you need to know it. Let me explain. Since his game is running at 60 FPS, that means that it will check enemy state 60 times every second. So your computer is doing all these extra calls that the player does not benefit from. A player does not need to know if enemy is dead or not every frame, every second. On top of that, it is wasting CPU resources that could be allocated somewhere else. In other words, this is what we call game optimization. You have to be very smart with how you distribute tasks for your computer. But remember that my friend had 10 enemies, which means that his CPU had to check for 10 enemies and not for one. For 10 enemies, that is 60 times 10, equals 600 checks every second. That's still okay if you are running on a high-end PC, but let's say that you are making a game for Android phones and it needs to run on a low-end Android phone, that could drastically affect its performance. And even though your high-end PC can eat all of this, it doesn't mean that you should keep doing this bad practice. Or on a job interview, an interviewer might dismiss you immediately if he notices that you are doing this beginner's mistake. Also, my friend had this code where he finds the distance between the player and the enemy, which was like 5 lines of code. Of course, I'm just making this up for this simplification. Now, let's do the math. 5 times 60 equals 300 calls and times 10 enemies, which is 3000 calls every second. Let's not forget from this other example those 1600 calls, which now adds up to 3600 calls every second. And this is one of the most common mistakes that every beginner does. Everything that they add to their game, they put it inside an update loop. And not just them, but also in these other YouTube tutorials, you can see it too. And that's exactly why you cannot escape the tutorial hell, is because you were never taught the best practices. 3600 calls may not be much, but things can add up easily. And now it could become 80,000 calls and your game could experience spikes, which is something you never want to happen. In an example where we check whether enemy is dead or not, instead we could do checks only when it's hit by a projectile. And now when projectile collides with the enemy, that's the only time where we're going to check the enemy state. So we don't need to check enemy state constantly like we did before. At max, let's say we can only shoot 15 projectiles in 1 second. That will make our worst case scenario 15. and that will reduce calls from 600 to 15. And our best case scenario is zero or no calls at all, because our enemy is not shooting. And if player does the shooting and misses all the enemies, that's still going to be zero calls because no enemy was collided with the projectile. If you remember, calls are only made when projectile successfully collides with the enemy. So we could make our projectiles disable self on collision, and that would make our CPU to only make calls on a single enemy. But in my friend's example, it made calls on every single enemy in the scene, even those that are not in the player's view. Now imagine a large game as a Grand Theft Auto, and if Rockstar developers checked if some random NPC at the other end of the map was alive. And imagine if they did that for the every NPC in the game. And do you know how many NPCs are there in GTA? Probably thousands. Do the math and see yourself how many calls are there. Of course, this is just an exaggerated example of our problem. Rockstar developers would never have some random NPC at the other end of the map loaded in the memory. Normally in games like these, an NPC would be loaded only when the player is close to him, and this is what we call object pooling, and we will discuss that in the future videos. Never call GetComponent in an update loop ever. It's a relatively expensive operation. It searches through all game objects in the scene hierarchy until it finds the one that you need, and it's a never good thing to do. What you want to do instead is to cache the reference in Awake or Start, or just drag the reference in the inspector. Another thing I want to add is to build a habit of using coroutines. Coroutines are way easier to handle than having the same code running in an update loop. It's way easier to stop a coroutine when it finishes, while an update loop can only be disabled when the game object is disabled. But what if you can't disable that game object? Then that update loop will keep running. I will make tutorial on coroutines, so if you didn't subscribe, please do it. This is a very common beginner mistake, and you are probably unaware that you are doing it. Never leave an update loop empty, ever, because Unity will call that update loop internally even though it's empty, and it will make unnecessary calls. It's the best practice to remove awake, onenable, start, update, fixed update, all those methods if they are empty. I used to do this as well. Don't go for an update loop immediately. 99% of the script that you are writing probably can be written outside of an update loop. If you are dealing with the UI stuff like player's health, enemy's health, remaining bullets, anything that needs to change constantly, all of that can be updated in a single frame. Don't even think of an update loop. What I recommend instead is to go for an event-driven solutions. And what do I mean by event-driven? As a beginner, I used to grab a player and grabs its health property, and then I would update that health constantly in an update loop. And so the CPU would tell the player, hey, this is your health, even when the health didn't change. So it's very important to make calls only when something actually changed and not every frame. Here's one more optimization tip that I will share with you. I have this Skeletons AR game that's, of course, an augmented reality game. In order for a player to be able to play the game, he has to place this turret on the ground. So for my phone to be able to place the turret on the ground, it has to run this ray from the phone in direction of the ground. And the only way to do this, it has to be run in an update loop. Raycasts are very expensive, so you don't want them to run when not used. So when I actually place the turret on the ground, I disable the game object that runs the raycast. So the CPU is not calculating the distance between the phone and the ground when the player is playing the game, because it doesn't benefit from knowing that information. And also the phone battery will last longer because of that. In conclusion, always disable game objects that run an update loop if possible. If you are looking for free Unity and programming tips, I built a community that you can join. I will provide the link in the description. It's still a new community that I'm looking to grow, and I'm always there, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask me. This is it, guys. If this video was helpful, please subscribe, and see you in the next video.